Hey, did you know that according to the ancient Greeks, the urine of an untainted boy has health benefits? Me personally, I just drink it for the flavor. While using pee for medicine might sound strange, history is full of stuff like this. Pope John the Whatever was a religious drinker of the devil's apple juice, and the Romans used to bathe themselves in the wee whiz of someone who ate cabbage. Now, if we go far enough back in time, we'll see that trepanning is the earliest case of bad medicine. This was the first surgery in history where a doctor would carve a hole in a person's skull to release bad spirits. This was used to treat people with head injuries, depression, or any other ailment of the dome. Another early treatment was bloodletting, where a doctor would cut someone open to drain them of bad blood. This one was used for pretty much anything, between headaches or a simple cold, all the way up to people on their deathbed. And while these aren't used very often anymore, depression is still sometimes cured by a hole in the head through a technique known as cobaining. As time moved on, medicine did get a bit better, but it still sucked. By the 1800s, doctors were struggling to figure out if a person was actually dead and not just knocked out. Because of this, the public was pretty scared of getting buried alive. So, to find out if a person was dead, doctors had lots of cool tests, such as jamming a needle into the heart to see if it moves, aggressively tweaking and tugging the nipples with sharp pliers, blowing smoke up the ass to warm the body, or just plain old cutting off fingers and toes. But the most common way of checking a body was to just let it rot for a bit, just to be safe. Obviously, these tests weren't foolproof. There's been a bunch of graves dug up, only to find scratch marks on the inside. This, of course, made the fear of live burial worse, so some inventors made safety coffins to give people a shot at surviving. I'm not really going to talk about these, since the designs all sucked and they never saved anyone, but what I am going to talk about is resurrection men, not to be confused with erection men. Those are two very different things. Until the late 1800s, anatomists had a hard time finding dead bodies to dissect, since, legally, they could only use the bodies of executed criminals. But since a law is only a law if you get caught, a black market for dead bodies popped up. People would break into graveyards and dig up the recently buried, and then sell them off to their local surgeon. At the time, business was booming, and it's theorized that most of the bodies used between the 1700s and 1800s were jacked. This isn't surprising, since a warm body could sell for about £1,000 in today's money, so when my channel inevitably dies, you can catch me at your grandma's funeral. At the time in the UK, it was basically legal to steal a corpse, since, when a person died, no one owned their body. So as long as you stripped them naked and left behind any valuables, the most you'd get is a slap on the wrist. But obviously watching your loved ones get their meat jacked kinda sucks, so people started to fight back. Iron coffins were used instead of wood, and metal cages called mort safes were used to protect them. And if that wasn't enough, there's also these tripwire shotgun traps, basically the thing from Rust. All these did, though, is cause the jackers of meat to innovate. In 1828, William Burke and William Hare got tired of finding and stealing dead bodies, so they decided to make some themselves. They would lure people back to their home with alcohol and other fun stuff, and once the victim was too inebriated to fight back, they'd suffocate them so they didn't ruin the body. From here, they'd sell the corpse to Dr. Robert Knox, who didn't mind where the bodies came from. This method of murder for dissection became known as burking, and the two did it a lot. They killed a total of 16 people, and they didn't care who it was. They'd burk off anyone. Men, women, they even burked off children and the disabled. After the 16th, though, they got caught. Knox's students found out when they saw he had the body of Daft Jamie, who was a local celebrity. The dude was kind of deformed, and he had a messed up foot that made him limp. So when his students identified the guy, Knox just cut off his head and foot, and then moved on. Like I said, Burke and Hare got caught, though. Same with Knox, but he faced no punishment. Hare took a deal to rat on his friend in exchange for immunity, so he got off scot-free, and Burke got the rope. Since it was standard for executed criminals, Burke was dissected. But for some reason, the weirdo who dissected him skinned his body and made him into a book, and he even wrote a note in his blood. Now, if you think being skinned and turned into a book is bad, imagine waking up from leg surgery without your nuts. This actually happened to some dude who went to Robert Liston, who was a British surgeon in the 1800s. Liston was known for his strength and speed, which mattered in the days before anesthetics. He was also one of the few surgeons to wash his hands and keep his area clean, since most at the time took pride in the surgical stink. But like I said, he had his issues too, like the time he amputated a guy's leg and took his manhood with it. Now, in my research, I couldn't find any record of what he did with the man's balls, so it's up to our interpretation. I like to think he took them home and displayed them on his mantelpiece. Or, perhaps, he fed them to his dog.
Bark. Bark.
Anyways, another one of his speedy mistakes happened when he was seeing a little boy. His assistant thought the growth on the kid's neck was an aneurysm and not safe to operate on. Liston didn't care, though, and he even mocked the guy, saying,
"Puh, preposterous, my dear boy. Who had ever heard of an aneurysm in someone so young?"
And since he was so confident, he quickly pulled out a knife and stabbed the boy in his lump.
Oh dear.
It turns out it was an aneurysm, and Liston had severed the kid's artery, which killed him on the spot. While this does sound bad, it's not even his worst surgery. Liston holds the record for the highest mortality rate in a single operation. At one point, he was amputating a patient's leg, and this time, he did leave the man's balls intact, but he moved so quick he somehow cut off three of his assistant's fingers, and then, on the backswing, cut a spectator which scared him so bad he died from shock. Only a couple days later, both the patient and his assistant died from infection, which gives him a record 300% mortality rate. I know at this point Liston sounds like a mouth-breathing moron, but other than ending a child, killing three people in one surgery, and neutering a grown man, he was actually a really good surgeon and a stand-up guy. He suspected that Dr. Knox dude from earlier was using resurrected bodies. So, he broke into his office, where he saw the corpse of a young woman posed inappropriately. This pissed him off so much that he fought Dr. Knox and took the body for a proper burial. He was also known for prioritizing his patient's comfort, and in a time where most surgeons lost about a quarter of their patients, he only lost 1 in 10. So yeah, despite all the kid killing and man mutilating, Liston was alright. The next guy, not so much. Dr. Walter Freeman was a neurologist and pioneer of the lobotomy, used all across America in the 1940s to 50s. Even if you don't know what a lobotomy is, you've probably experienced the results firsthand if you've ever been on YouTube Shorts. It was a surgery where the frontal lobe of a victim's brain would be severed. In the early days, this was done by drilling a hole in the skull and then dumping alcohol on the brain. But, eventually, proper tools were made. Freeman got tired of doing things the standard way, though, since his tools kept getting stuck in his patient's head. Because of this, he came up with the grapefruit technique, where instead of drilling through the skull, he would just ram an ice pick through the eye bone and swirl it around till the person was sufficiently brain dead. Now, the technique gets its name from the way it was created, at home, in his kitchen, by demolishing a grapefruit. This is different than the other technique of the same name, where you simulate f***ing and s***ing a dude by giving him a blowjob while drinking his piss with a grapefruit. Anyways, Dr. Freeman was a weirdo. He advertised his new technique at conventions by displaying lobotomized animals, and when reporters saw how calm and subdued the animals were, they would write about his new miracle surgery. Not long after, Freeman was traveling all across the USA, lobotomizing any annoying housewife and hyperactive child he could find. His station wagon was even nicknamed the Lobotomobile, because he'd operate while road tripping with his family. The fun times eventually came to an end, though, since his surgeries were getting a bad rep, and people realized being brain dead isn't much better than just being depressed. In one case, he accidentally killed a patient when he left his ice pick in the guy's brain to take a photo. The thing slipped deeper in there, which killed him on the spot. Finally, in 1967, after destroying the brain of JFK's sister and killing a total of almost 500 patients, Freeman was officially banned from doing lobotomies. But for the ones he didn't kill, they had to live the rest of their lives partially brain dead, just like Joe Rogan.
Cheeseburgers.
Alright, so the last bit of bad medicine I want to talk about is Dr. Benjamin Rush. This dude is considered the founding father of American psychiatry, but he's a literal founding father too. Rush was one of the first doctors to say mental illness came from illness of the mental and not from being possessed. But even though he was smart enough to graduate from Princeton at 14, he still believed in some pretty dumb stuff. Like, during the yellow fever outbreak of 1793, he thought it came from the smell of rotting coffee beans and not the real cause, which was mosquitoes. And during that same outbreak, he kinda lost his mind. He thought God chose him to be the savior and to cure the sick through bloodletting. In reality, though, he drained his patients like a Capri Sun and a lot of them died. Another unusual fact about Rush is the way he treated the mentally ill. He thought his manic patients got peace and clarity from pain, so he tried to inflict as much as possible. He would dump acid on them or create wounds with a knife, which he kept open for months or even years. If that didn't work, he'd pull out the tranquilizer chair. This was an alternative to the straitjacket, and patients would be stuck here for a couple hours. It had a little poop chute at the bottom, and at the top was a sensory deprivation head enclosure, which is just fancy speak for dark box make vision go bye-bye. Rush also believed in treating people with depression using spin therapy. He had a device that would spin a person around at Mach 10 until they supposedly felt better. But, most of the time, patients would just throw up or piss themselves, and if they went too fast, their brain might hemorrhage. So yeah, the father of American medicine believed in strapping the mentally ill to Beyblades, and in the 1800s, your chances of getting post-mortem medically meat molested were quite high. So, I hope this video gave you a newfound appreciation for modern medicine. Either way, thank you for watching. I'll see you next time. Bye.